So the person in the back has been waiting for a while.
So as I was listening, initially I was thinking that that the goal of your morality would be to seek your own good, but then it sounded like through discussing the flood and things like that, that it's not a kind of a self-seeking, but it's more of seeking the good of the world. And so that got me thinking, what if your body was infested with viruses and bacteria and parasites, and you could take medication to kill off everything that you didn't want, but it would be bad for the parasites and so forth that were inside of you. Would it be moral to take the medicine and you know, kill those things that are living inside of you so that you can survive when you're, and it's you know.
Sure, yeah. I mean, yeah, that would lead to human flourishing. Basically, it's just medicine is what you're talking about. So, yeah. Yeah, and then I think one thing you're kind of leading up to also is animal rights. I mean, in our state of human maturity or immaturity, I mean, we are starting to understand now about morality is all about flourishing, and that's a big improvement. And once we get there, then the next step is going to be concerned more about animals, which some people are like vegans because they don't like, you know, the animals suffering and stuff. So I mean, we need to go step by step. There's a lot of things there we need to do also. But
so does human flourishing take priority over animal flourishing then?
See, that's a good tough question. And like I said, it's like in a society we're not even there yet because we're still trying to figure out about human flourishing. I mean, we're not even on the same page as that yet. So
I'll probably get the same response, but I want to ask just to see what you think. But would adult flourishing take priority over children flourishing, or how do we make that hierarchy of? And would an elite racist flourishing take priority over an inferior racist flourishing?
Race, did you say?
Yeah. You know, how do we rank?
Yeah, I mean, well, as far as races, I mean, usually in biology they say there's no discernible difference. I mean, that's one thing about we need to mature. I mean, like I was talking about earlier, there's a lot of tribal morality. Like for example, Americans are exceptional, right? Everybody. You know, France thinks they're exceptional, and we're going to look out for our interests in the world. And where we need to get to is what they call a planetary morality, where we need to look at the world, all the humans, as one tribe. And so that's, you know, that's another place we're trying to get to. These are good questions as far as, like, I mean, those are good philosophical questions. Those are for class, you know. It's like, would you save one child or a young child or an old lady who's only got 1 year to live? Who should you save if you could only save one? I mean, those are good, perplexing questions. But at least you're in the right area instead of saying, like, well, God says this, or I think the right feeling is what I feel in my heart. I mean, those are going down the wrong road because they're not based on anything.
They're not satisfying. Just in the remaining time, if you don't mind sharing, I'm curious, how did you become a Christian and how did you become a non-Christian?
I wrote a why I'm not a Christian anymore. Actually, on this handout here, I have a free online book. It's called Modern Science and Philosophy Destroys Christian Theology. So basically, I left because of, as I learned more about science and philosophy, especially biology and neurology. But I was raised a Roman Catholic. I was confirmed in around high school time. And then right after college, I became a born-again evangelical Christian about 1984. And since then, I grew in the faith as an evangelical born-again Christian. And then in 2007, I left the faith. No, 2009, actually.
And what was it specifically that you saw in science that drew you?
I got a minute, I guess. Like I said, in science, for example, with biology, with evolution, we know there's no such thing as a first human. There was no Adam, first biological human. And so basically that really does a lot of damage to the gospel. And then in neurology, we find out that there is no soul, there is no you in your brain. What you are is a composite of everything your brain is doing. So in a nutshell, if there's no little you in there, there's nothing to resurrect. I mean, we are basically a biological machine. We're a meat-based computer. Versus a silicon-based computer.
How do we get rudeness from that?
So, you know, if there's no ghost in the machine, there's no ghost to resurrect, and that's the heart of the gospel. It all goes out the window once you realize there's no ghost in the machine, so.